Good morning, Mount Carmel. Thank you for joining us for Church Online. We hope that you enjoy today's service. Your response matters. Please fill out your 2020 census form today. Census results help determine how billions of dollars in federal funding flow into states and communities each year. If you need assistance filling out your forms, please call the church office at 574-287-1451. Attention Mount Carmel family, we will resume in-person worship services on Sunday, June 7th. More information will be shared via our Facebook page and our website within the next coming weeks on how we plan to keep our congregation safe and healthy while attending services. Please stay tuned for more information. How can we pray for you? Please submit your prayer requests by calling our church office at 574-287-1451 and a member of our ministry will reach out to you. If you would like to stay up to date on everything that's happening at Mount Carmel, please join our email list. You can sign up on our website at www.mountcarmelmbc.com.
They are more than just names. More than blocks of stone set in rows. More than memories. They are our brothers and sisters. Our parents and our children. Friends, loved ones, and even strangers who believe that we were worth fighting for. That we were worth dying for. They stand for justice, for courage, for heroism and fearlessness in the face of danger. They stand for the brave men and women who selflessly answered the call and gave their very lives for the cause of freedom. Let us never take their sacrifice for granted, but instead remember with gratitude those who have served. Today, tomorrow, and every day thereafter. By the grace of God, if we walk upon free soil, if we breathe in the sweetness of liberty, let us give thanks. Let us honor the fallen. Let us never forget.
I know that you're a winner on today. Come on, if you believe it, go ahead and stand to your feet and celebrate the fact that you're a winner. Come on, come on, stand up all over the field and help us worship.
We're winners now. Thank you. Good morning, my brothers and sisters. It's an honor and a privilege to be with you once again on Sunday morning. I thank God for you inviting me into your home. I want you to know that you are constantly in my prayers. We're thinking about you. We're looking forward to our time back together soon. Now, I know that we have a tentative date right now to unite together back the first Sunday of June. You'll be seeing more details coming your way. Please pay close attention to the Facebook page and to our website with more information, because things have completely changed, and we're going to relaunch the ministry, and we're going to do some things a little bit different than we have done in the past. So please keep those things in mind. If you have any questions, you're welcome always to call the church, and we'll give you more insight on more to come. Amen. Let's go into prayer, and I'll share with you what God has given to me on this day to be with you, and I think it'll bless you to minister, because it's blessed me this week. Let us pray. Awesome God, we just thank you for being a very present Savior, our gentle Redeemer, the one that keeps us in our coming and our going. And we just love you that you allowed us to come together one more time. We just thank you for this moment that we get a chance to spend your word. Lord, I pray that you would move powerfully through your word for someone to hear and change, and someone come saying, what must I do to receive Jesus Christ as my personal Savior? So I thank you now for your word that'll go forth. Lord, bless us in our time together. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. For the time that we had together on this morning, I want to share with you a scripture from the 18th book of Psalms and the 35th verse, reading from a New Living Translation that I think will bless us tremendously. And it reads like this: You have given me your shield of victory. Your right hand supports me. Your help has made me great. For the time that we have together on this morning, I want to use for a topic titled In the Hand of God. I think that'll bless us tremendously, because I think this is a real unique verse from the book of Psalms. And I love Psalms because Psalms always have pictures and that show us how blessed we are as children of God. King David is the writer of this particular Psalms, and he's now putting together all his various thoughts that have passed through his mind at this time. King David is no longer a kid in the pasture, but he's now the king in the palace. And Saul is no longer around to interfere with King David's life. You do remember King Saul, don't you? He was the one that constantly gave David a hard time over and over again. Not only is David king, but one of David's great accomplishments as king was to bring the kingdom together. He had a problem that the southern kingdom and the northern kingdom had been divided for years, and they had been divided for many, many years. But now Israel and Judah are now no longer divided, and they had been divided for years because of war. But now King David has brought them together, and King David is now the leader of both the kingdoms. And so a lot has taken place. We all need to know also that David's journey of life is showing us a unique picture, because David in our text this morning is painting a picture of his life journey. And you do know that David had a unique life. David had strangers that were constantly trying to attack him. He had also violent, dangerous people that was constantly trying to kill him, because David was a unique leader for the kingdom of God. David's life, my brothers and sisters, was a life that was similar to a roller coaster ride. He had ups and he had downs. David had to deal with oppression. He had to deal with torture. He had to deal with hardships. He had to deal with adversities. He had to deal with many difficulties. He had trials. And yes, David even suffered. My brothers and sisters, David is writing to you and I on this morning that and he's wanting you and I to know him this morning, that after all he's been through, the only reason why David survived everything that came against him, he's saying, because God's hand was on his life. Let me suggest on this morning that long before Marvin Sapp composed and wrote and sung the song, I Never Would Have Made It, David exhibited publicly a life of expression that he would have never made it if it hadn't been for God's hand on his life. David wants you and I to know on this morning that the only reason why he didn't lose his mind, the only reason why he never gave up, is because he realized that God's hand was on his life. And if you haven't caught it yet, I really want you to catch it this morning, that the only reason why you're still safe. And the reason why you still have your joy is because God's hand is on your life. David, in this Psalms, is simply recognizing the fact that God is committed to those who keep their hands clean, and God is committed to those that's willing to keep their heart pure, and he's committed to anybody that constantly seeks God's face. David is showing us today the nature of a unique praise. And David is strongly suggesting, my brothers and sisters, that anybody that know that it's been God that have brought them through seen and unseen danger ought to take the time and tell God, thank you for bringing me through. Ought to take the time and tell somebody that the only reason why you made it is because God's hand has been on your life. Matter of fact, David is telling us clearly in this particular writing that we no longer need to take credit for what God has done, but we need to give God the credit for all the marvelous things that he has done in our life. Matter of fact, while you're at home sitting in your living room today, or you out in the yard, wherever you're at right now driving your car, you ought to go announce it publicly and let Satan know that it's because of God's hand on your life. That's why you still have joy, you still have happiness, you still have peace. Somebody ought to give God a big hand praise this morning because of the hand of God that's on your life. David is now putting together all of his thoughts, and he's taking time to bring back to memory of all the great things that God has done for him personally in his life. And that's what the 18th book of Psalms is about. The 18th book of Psalms is a Psalms of celebrating a great victory after victory. The 18th book of Psalms is a Psalms to talk about completion in his own personal life. The 18th book of Psalms is a reflection of the many things that God had brought David through. Everything that come against him, it was the hand of God that brought him through. And David is publicly, yes, he's realizing that the only reason why he made it is because of God helping him go through life's battle. David is realizing this, and the only reason why David is sharing this with us because he wants you to understand that the same God that blessed him is the same God that's able to keep you in your coming and your going. David is letting you know, my brothers and sisters, it's because of God's hand. It's his hand that brought him from the pasture to the palace. It was God's hand that kept David in the valley to the mountaintop. It was God's hand that kept David from a boy to a man. It has been God's hand that kept David from the shepherd to the king. It's only because of God's hand that David can say publicly that God has sustained him in his coming and his going. And he's not the only one that can testify. There's got to be somebody that's listening to me this morning that don't mind letting somebody know that all that you have, that everything you came through is not because of your ability, but it's because God's hand has been on your life. My brothers and sisters, that excites me because David is writing to us on this morning, and David is letting us know it's because of God that the enemy can't destroy what God has blessed. If you listen to David's writing on this morning, you'll discover that David this morning is talking about an awesome God. Now, David hadn't always talked this way about God, but this morning he's letting you and I know it's the hand of God, because David in this particular writing is evaluating his life, and he comes to a conclusion again. It's God that brought me through. It's God that kept me in my coming and my going. It's God that opened doors that was closed in my face. It's God that shielded me from the hands of the enemy. It's God's protection that has continually blessed me all the day long. David in his writing is letting us know how blessed he is. And David says in verse 1 that he's so blessed that he wants to take the time now and recognize and tell you and I it's God. Listen to what he says in verse 1. He says, I love you, Lord. You are my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my savior. My God is my rock in whom I find protection. He is my shield, the power that saves me and my place of safety. I called on the Lord who is worthy of praise, and he saved me from my enemies. You hear what he's saying? David is going back in his life, and he comes to a conclusion that I love the Lord because he heard my cry. I love the Lord because he protected me from every seen and unseen danger that came against me. You're looking at me strange on this morning out there, but I'm trying to tell somebody that the truth of the matter is that all of us must come to one conclusion that God's hand has been on our life. Now, I know it's hard for some of you to recognize when God's hand is on your life, because some of you have a hard time even seeing the fingerprints of God on your life. Because when you're going through your mess, it's hard to see God working things out. Because when we're losing jobs and we're losing loved ones and we're losing homes or losing cars or losing different items or going through hard times in the workplace or just struggling in life, it's hard to see God's hand on your life when you're sick and you're going through a divorce. It's hard to see God's hand when things are hard. But my brothers and sisters, if you would just take the time and look, you'll discover that he's been there all the time, that God's hand is always there working things out for your good. Now, it doesn't feel good when you're going through, but the good news is you're going to come through. It may be painful and you may have to go through, but there's victory after you come through. And because of knowing God's hand is on our life, we're blessed. We as a people have a tendency from time to time to want to keep our hands on our situation. And when we keep our hands on our situations, we have a problem seeing the hand of God. But if you ever take your hand off of your situation and allow God's hand to be on your situation, then you'll discover that God is working things out for my good. Matter of fact, let me tell somebody that God's hand is bigger than your hand. And if you let God keep you and you let God's hand be in control of your life, then you'll have a greater outcome when you trust in God. David is strongly suggesting to you and I on this morning that God is not some far distant God, that God is a very present God. Matter of fact, Jesus in the New Testament, he believes it also, because he says in the book of John, the 10th chapter, verse 27, he says, "My sheep listen to my voice, and I know them, and they follow me." Then Jesus goes on to say in verse 29, "For my Father has given them to me, and he is more powerful than anyone else. No one can snatch them from the Father's hand." Did you hear what I just said? When you're in God's hand, no one has the power to take you out of the hand of God. Ooh-wee. You ought to take time right now and give God a praise for the hand that's on your life. You ought to go and testify and tell somebody that his hand is keeping me. His hand is holding me. That the reason why I still have all of my joy is because God's hand is on my life. My brothers and sisters, hear me this morning, that when God's hand is on your life, it blesses your coming and your going. His hand blows my mind, because the fact that God shows up and intervenes in my situation lets me know that God cares for me and he loves me and his grace and mercy is ever present. Because the one that created me and created the world and made us in his likeness and his image have time for all of our little situations, let us see how blessed we are as children of God. My brothers and sisters, I gotta tell you again, go on, celebrate. Tell your husband, tell your wife, tell your children that the reason why we're going to survive COVID-19, because we're under the hand of God. When I look at this particular verse, the 18th book of Psalms in the 35th verse, it blesses me because it says, "You have given me your shield of victory. Your right hand supports me. Your help has made me great." The first thing I want to share with you on this morning that I want to leave with you is this right here, that you have victory in your life. Yes, yes. If you stay under the shield of victory. Now I need to tell somebody this morning that God had equipped David for every battle that he had went through. My brothers and sisters, the same way God equipped David, God has equipped you. Do you know that David was hunted down by Saul, but Saul couldn't touch him? Saul couldn't get near him. Why? Because God's hand was on David's life. And when Saul was ever so close, there almost to get David, David couldn't be touched by Saul because God began to intervene and he took Saul away from chasing David to go back to his home country because the Palestinians had came in and attacked Saul's land. And because of that, he had to stop chasing David so he can go and protect his land. But y'all, it wasn't the Palestinians that interrupted Saul's chase of David. It was God that interfered. Matter of fact, my brothers and sisters, when you are under the protection of God, God always reveals to you things that you need to make it through every obstacle that come your way. I just said something. It was Saul's son, Jonathan, that kept David informed, that told David over and over again the strategies that his father had set against him. But because God's hand was on David, y'all, Saul's best laid plans couldn't touch what God has blessed. I got to say it again. You ought to go and tell somebody that I'm blessed in my coming and my going, that God's hand is on my life so well that I'm covered with God's blessings, that the enemy can't have what God has blessed. And so this verse says to you and I that God has equipped us for battle. And you need to know this morning that God has also equipped not only David, but you and I to be successful against everything that comes against us. How do I know that? Because it says this, that it says that God has given us his shield. Now, if you look at the Roman soldiers, they would carry rectangle shields, and y'all, they would take those rectangle shields that was curved and that it would fit over their whole body and protect them. They would take them into battle. So if they had to kneel down, they could put it in front of them and an enemy couldn't fire darts against them. Or if something came ahead of them, they could put it over their head and they was covered. And if something came on the side of them, they would keep themselves covered by the shield. This shield was made of light wood, and then it had leather on it, and then it had metal or steel to hold things together. Now, a good soldier kept oil with them, and they kept the shield oiled because when the shield was oiled, it had longer life. It had strength to endure anything that came against it. And what I'm trying to suggest, that the oil is a metaphor of the Holy Spirit, that when you walk under the shield of God, you are walking under the oil of God. And when you walk under the oil of God, you are anointed in your coming and your going. And when you know that you're anointed, you start testifying that no weapon formed against me shall prosper. Why? I'm under the hand of God. And because I'm under the hand of God, he fights against everything that comes against me. Y'all, Roman soldiers had shields to protect them in their coming and going. And you have a shield, and that's the word of God to protect you, that gives you peace in the midst of crisis, that calms your nerves when the enemy come up against you. And you have to stay in the word of God so you can keep the shield to fight off everything that come against you. Now, I can hear somebody say, Reverend, that sounds real good, but you need to understand this, Pastor. I've been hit and I've been bruised and I'm discouraged and I'm hurt and I don't think I can go on. Well, I'm sorry to hear that, but let me tell you why you've been hit. Let me discuss with you why you're discouraged. Let me tell you why you've lost hope. It's because you're not walking with your shield. And brothers and sisters, when you don't walk with your shields, you are exposing yourself to the hand of the enemy. And when you take your covering off, then you are vulnerable to be attacked by the enemy that comes against you. But
they that keep themselves under the word of God and live by the word of God, they walk in victory and they declare that victory is mine because I'm walking under the power of God. That's what that oil represents. It represents that we walk under the anointing of the Holy Spirit that comforts us, that guides us, that keeps us in our coming and our going. And if you don't have that peace, you need to evaluate your walking with the word of God, because when you have the word of God, it gives you peace beyond your understanding. I need to let you know that when you walk with the word of God, you have an effective life. And when you stay in the word of God and stay with your shield, you're blessed in your coming and you're blessed in your going. But then also, I want to share with you this morning that when I look at David's writing, David says to us clearly this morning that because of God's hand on my life, I'm blessed. Now, that's my topic on this morning, and I want to bring this back to the closure of this morning, let you know the importance of God's hand on your life. Verse 35 says again, you have given me your shield of victory. Your right hand supports me. Your help has made me great. The right hand of God, church, represents God's authority. The right hand of God speaks of the power of God. The right hand of God shows us that God is more than what we can imagine, that God is all powerful. He's almighty. The right hand of God shows us, my brothers and sisters, that he represents us with his hand. And because his hand is on us, we have the authority of God to fight and resist everything that comes against us. Now, this is an awesome illustration, because when David uses this word, the right hand of God, David is talking to people in their culture, and he's dealing with a matter of culture, because David realized that most people were right-handed. More people are right-handed than left-handed, and he realized that right-handed people are skillful. And David is suggesting that people can relate to the statement right hand. Now, 90% of the population right now in America are right-handed people. Left-handed people are far and less, but people that realize the strength in the right hand, they realize how strong it is. And David is painting an illustration of the right hand of God. And if you think your right hand is strong, then you need to start realizing how strong God's right hand is. David is painting the picture to us how strong that one hand, how it's more dominant than the left hand, that when you fall, you reach down with the right hand first to catch yourself. If you're climbing something, you use the right hand to pull yourself up first. When you open the door, you use the strongest hand. When you even preparing your meal, you use the one hand that you know you can count on. And when you're writing things, you use your right hand, because that's the dominant hand. And David is painting a picture that God's hand is more stronger than our hand. And he says that his right hand protects us. Y'all, historically, you need to know that when the enemy would come in to try to invade the camps that God had established, that the enemy would take the children of God and take them into slavery, and they would take their right hand and destroy it, because they thought that if they would lose the strength of the right hand, they would never be a threat no more. But God is saying to you and I that his hand is so strong that nobody can destroy it, that nobody can hurt it. And God says to us clearly that if you're in his hand, nobody has the power to take you out of his hand. Y'all, hear me this morning. When we think about the right hand of God, brothers and sisters, we have to consider the power behind the statement that David gives us. We must begin to ask the question, who and what is the right hand of God? We need to know this morning, there's none other than Jesus Christ himself. In other words, your support and strength in this life is found in God's glorious Son by the name of Jesus, the one who withstood Satan in the wilderness, the one that crushed Satan on Calvary's hill, the one that conquered death and hell. He was the one that delivered us from the bondage of sin. God is saying to us in this verse this morning through David's writing that God's right hand is Jesus Christ himself. And if Jesus Christ is your strength, then you ought to let somebody know that he's a mighty Savior, that he's a mighty God, that the right hand is the authority, and the authority of God cannot be destroyed. How do I know that? You know this, because one Friday on a hill called Calvary, they tried to destroy the right hand of Jesus Christ. But you do know that he died, but he didn't stay dead. He got up early Sunday morning with all power in his hand. And my brothers and sisters, he's still alive. And what I'm trying to put in somebody's spirit on this morning, the right hand of our Lord and Savior sustains us in our coming and going. Listen to me this morning. Listen to me this morning. Don't you worry about a thing. Don't you worry about what the world has to say. Don't you worry about what they say against you. As long as you have God's hand on your life, you got victory in your life. And having victory in your life is not a feeling, it's what you know. It's not what they see, it's what you know. And my word to somebody on this morning, please hear this morning, God's hands on your life. Believe this, that God loves you too much to let you fail. And I close by telling you on this morning, there is no failure in the God that we serve. God loves you. I pray that you receive this word this morning. I'm looking forward to seeing us again. And I thank God for the moment of sharing the word of God with you. May God bless you and God keep you. If you're looking for a church home, I would love to be your pastor. If you have not received Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you can receive Jesus Christ right there by receiving him as your personal Savior. Just acknowledge it with your mouth that you thank God that one Friday he died for your sins and you are saved. And so may God keep you, and I'll see you real, real soon. Be blessed.